Sangeeta Vishwakarma. So today we'll start up with the topic of ray optics. We'll have a quick revision on ray optics, whatever we had completed yet from this chapter. Okay? In the basics of ray optics, what we had seen first is law of reflection. I hope we remember what do we understand by optics. Optics is all about study of light. Of optics is basically the physics in which we study the rays which pass straight to the object and then they reflect into the human eye so that we can be able to see the front object. Okay, in this chapter, the most basic topic we are going to cover is law of reflection and refraction, what we had already been studied in the lower classes. So law of reflection is all about angle of incidence and angle of reflection. So we know that basic Snell's law is whenever the ray of the light is incident on the plane surface, it gets reflected by in the same medium. So in this theory or in this concept, we know the angle of incidence is always equal to angle of reflection. And the second statement here clearly we need to understand is that ray of incidence, ray of reflection and your plane or whatever the plane mirror must lie in the these three things must lie in the same plane, right? After this, here when you study about optics, the reflection and refraction theory do comes with the concept to the mirrors. In this thing we are going to study about the reflections and refractions with respect to the mirrors, wherein we will complete or cover mostly with the spherical mirrors and the lenses. So in that case, we always have to remember that here there are certain rules which we need to follow, which we call as Cartesian rules. In this rules, whenever we consider a spherical mirror, the spherical mirror, whatever the light directions are going to get imposed on this mirror, so this direction of light is always considered to be positive. Whenever we are moving towards the mirror, then this direction, or whenever the object is moving towards the pole, that direction is considered to be positive. And whenever we are moving from right to left or in the opposite direction of the incidence, that part is considered to be negative. Similarly, when you talk about mirror, the principal axis which we are seeing includes center of curvature, focus and pole. The point of the mirror here in between, the aperture of this mirror is considered to be very small. So this point wherein your principal axis is intersecting the mirror is considered to be the pole. Okay? And exactly the center point of the mirror, if we consider this mirror to be the circle, then this point C is said to be the center of curvature. Okay? So here, above the principal axis, whatever points or directions you are considering, that will be positive. And below the principal axis, whenever you are calculating the height of the image or height of the object, consideration will be negative below the principal axis. Okay, these are the most basic things which you need to remember. Now, talking back or seeing the same thing, reflections and refractions. Reflections do occur in the same medium, and refraction occurs in the different medium. So what are the laws of refraction we had studied? Law of refraction was what? Here we are considering a glass slab. When we are taking a incident, whenever we are incidenting a light from a rarer medium to denser medium, then what happens? Your refracted ray will move towards the normal, right? So here if you are considering theta 1 to be the angle of incidence, theta 2 will be the angle of refraction, right? So here according to Snell's, the law of reflection says that sin I upon sin r will be equal to the refractive index of medium 2 with respect to medium 1, right? And therein, how do we define refractive index of the medium? Refractive index of the medium will be the velocity of light in the air with respect to the velocity of light in the that particular medium, whatever second medium we are considering for the refraction, that medium will be that medium's speed for the light will be considered. Okay. Okay, then talking about mirror equation, whenever we are designing a mirror or a spherical surface is what we consider as a mirror, in that we mostly have two types. We have concave mirrors and convex mirrors. So there are certain rules wherein which we can consider in order to make sure that whatever our image is being generated is because of different sign conventions we consider. So whenever we need to create an image of a certain object, we have to make sure there are at least two rays which we will be using in order to generate an image. So there are four rays rules you need to remember. First is that when your ray is passing parallel to the principal axis, then that reflection will be passing through focus of the mirror. Okay, this is your first thing. Second, whenever the ray is passing through the focus, then the reflected ray will become parallel to the principal axis. Then if your ray is passing through the center of curvature, then your reflected ray will be exactly retracing the path, right? And finally, if the ray is incidented on your spherical mirror, then it will simply follow your law of reflection, right? Wherein we say the angle of incidence will become equal to the angle of reflection. So whenever we need to generate a certain image of any object, we have to make sure or we have to consider at least two rays whose either convergence or divergence has to be taken into picture in order to create the image. Okay. For that, whenever we are considering the mirror, there is a certain mirror equation which we need to use in order to make sure that our mirror is perfectly generating the image of our need. So that mirror equation, so do remember the rays rules, four rays rules, that when your ray is passing from the focus, then the reflected ray will be parallel to the principal axis. Secondly, when your ray is passing through is parallel to the principal axis, then the reflected ray will be passing through the focal of the focal point of the mirror. Then third was when your ray is passing through the center of the curvature, then the reflected ray will again retrace the path. And finally, whenever the ray of light is making certain angle at the aperture of the mirror, then that will be following the rule of reflection. Okay. So here in mirror equation, we see the mirror formula to be 1 upon V plus 1 upon U will be equal to 1 upon F, wherein your F is the focal length of the mirror, 1 upon U here U will be, U is object's placement, okay, the distance of the object from the pole, exactly at the pole we are going to find the distance. So whatever is the mirror, mirror's pole and the distance of the object is considered as U, and at whatever part we are going to get V, that is the images generated, that distance is considered to be V. So hence we get mirror formula to be 1 upon F is equal to 1 upon V mirror formula is 1 upon V is equals 1 upon F is equals to 1 upon V plus 1 upon U. And in this same case we have a concept of magnification. So linear there are two types of magnification which we learn. In lenses we have two magnifications which are called as linear magnification and angular magnification. In mirror we are considering only one magnification, that is linear magnification, that is given by what? It is normally, we need to understand whatever object we are placing in front of the mirror, what exactly will be the height of the image which will be generated, so that we can just adjust the height or the distance of the object from the mirror. Okay, so here the height of the image and height of the object's relation is given by the magnification. So magnification is, formula is M is equals to height of the image to height of the object. Kya problem hai iska? Mere ko lag raha tha maine kiya, bhi ho raha hai. Okay, theek hai. So this is the mirror formula and magnification's formula, that M is equals to height of the image to height of the object, which is given by M is equals to minus V upon U. Okay, so here two things you need to keep in mind is, when magnification is negative, the image generated is real and inverted, and when your magnification is positive, your image generated is virtual. Okay, virtual and erected. Okay, so this was all about mirror's formula. After this we have the concept of total internal reflection. Okay, so in total internal reflection, what terms we need to remember, or what the most important concept here to understand is, what do you understand by critical angle? What is critical angle? When the angle of incidence corresponding to which angle of refraction is 90 degree, right? So when you take the relation that mu 21 is equals to sin I upon sin r, okay, this relation, when we consider mu is equals to, mu is equals to what? Sin I upon sin r, right? So here angle of critical angle is considered to be IC, for which your refraction will be 90 degrees. Okay, so in this case, if I am substituting this value, so what I'll get, sin of IC will become equal divided by sin of 90. That will be clearly giving me critical angle's sin value. So hence in this case we say that refractive index will be equal to sin of the critical angle. So here the concept of total internal reflection lies that whenever we consider that your ray of light is passing from certain denser medium to rarer medium. So first thing to remember here is that whenever your ray of light is passing from denser to rarer, then what happens? Your ray is moving away from the normal. Okay, so here in first case we had clearly seen that whenever a ray of light is passing straight, that is this will act as a normal. So here there will be no reflection or refraction causing to this type of a ray. Secondly, when we bend this ray of light and make a certain angle of incidence at this part, then this ray, when it is passing from denser medium to rarer medium, it is slightly moving away from the normal. So, as we go on increasing the angle of incidence, here, till the point where we are increasing angle of incidence, this ray or refracted ray will move away from the normal. There will be a certain time when the angle of incidence will become such that this angle of refraction will become 90 degrees. That is, when we incident the ray with the critical angle, this refraction or the refracted ray will pass through the medium or from above the medium. So, here we say that angle of refraction is 90 degrees. So, the point when the critical angle is increased by or is more than critical angle, then what happens? This refracted ray will then further get away from the normal of the point, and hence we can see now the refracted ray will become will be refracted, or we can say this is coming again back into the same medium, and this concept is said as total internal reflection. Okay, so in total internal reflection, only the term you need to remember is that whenever your angle of incidence becomes greater than critical angle, then instead of refracting into the other medium, the ray is completely getting reflected back in the same medium, and hence the name comes that total internal reflection. Okay, so here the total ray is being reflected back into the same medium. So here you need to just remember one formula, that mu is equals to sine of IC. And if they are asking you to calculate IC, how will you find IC? IC will be that angle for which refraction is 90 degrees. Okay. What happened? कुछ भी हो रहा है वो अपने आप ही. मैं कुछ भी नहीं कर रही हूँ. आई स्टे अवे स्टिल, वो चेंज हो रहा है अपने आप ही.
इधर टच झाला ना तरी रिएक्ट करें.
नहीं, बट आई वाज नॉट टचिंग ना, फिर भी चेंज हो रहा था. रिएक्ट करने उसको कौन बोल रहा है रिएक्ट करने में? नीचे नीचे इंटरनल रिफ्लेक्शन तक आया था. इमेजेस दूसरे हो गए. किधर गया यार? There was a mirage question. Okay. In total internal reflection, we have its application to be studied. So, therein you have 4 points to remember. That is, first is, for most important is mirage, then will be for the prisms, diamonds and optical fibers. Okay. So here this is most important question. This has to be studied without any mistake. Okay, what do you understand by mirage? And what happens in the areas where the temperature is quite of high? What happens, like in desert, if we consider the region of desert, then the area below or near the ground, near the surface, is having much higher temperature as compared to the temperature at a certain height. So what happens whenever a person is looking at a certain object? Here you can see, if that man is looking at a certain object, then what happens, this rays which are being reflected till the point they are coming down, then what happens here at a certain point, since the temperature is increasing, then as your temperature increases, then your refractive index is going to decrease. Okay, and hence at a certain point, till the ray is moving, and your refractive index will be decreasing within the certain range and coming up to this ground. Then what happens here at certain point, your angle of incidence will become equal to critical angle, and after the point wherein this angle even becomes greater than the critical angle, so here the total internal reflection is going to occur. So here whatever ray was about to incident on his eye will be incidented after a certain total internal reflection, and hence this person assumes that the ray of light will be coming something from the below the ground area, and hence he feels that there is a certain kind of mirage being generated, and this is the mirage which is the effect which is generated because of the total internal reflection. Okay, so here only two terms you need to remember while writing the note, that as you are going below or as the height is reducing, your temperature is increasing, and for the higher temperatures your refractive index reduces. Okay, so when the light has been incident at a certain point, the incident angle of the light will become greater than critical angle, and there will be a total internal reflection produced. So this ray will be reflected directly into the human's eye, which will be filled as if, or illuminated as if, it is coming from somewhere under the ground. So here we feel that there is a water block here or water body here, and hence in desert areas we feel that there are the certain water bodies at a certain places near the objects, because it is being generated because of this total internal reflections effect. Okay, in this you also have to include three more terms, that is optical fibers, prisms and your diamonds, right? Now here total internal reflection for diamonds is considered because whenever you talk about diamonds, diamonds do shine, right? But here that shine that comes, or that brilliance or sparkles that comes into the body of the diamond, is because of this total internal reflection. So whenever people manufactured the diamonds, the sharpening of the diamonds is done in such a way that whatever the ray of light will be entering the diamond's body will be encountering multiple total internal reflections. Okay, because of multiple total internal reflection, what happens, that diamond starts shining brighter. Okay, so hence more of than the diamond, the sharpness of the diamonds do matter, because the sharpness is what we need to consider that will make sure that your diamonds is shining because of that multiple total internal reflection that is occurring in the body. Okay, then talking about prisms, the third application is prisms. In prisms we'll see that prisms are designed in such a way that it could either convert or reflect, generate a certain image which will be inverted by either 90 degree or 180 degree, with the same concept of total internal reflection. Okay, and finally we have optical fibers. In optical fibers, what do we mean by optical fibers? In optical fibers, what we do, optical fibers, from one end the light has been incident in such a way that the light will pass from one end of the wire to another end of the wire. This makes sure that if there is no loss of the data, whatever we are sending from this point, from a certain point to other point. And secondly, the speed also increases, and loss is also reduced. Okay, So, the optical fibers are something wherein you transfer the data in the form of the light, and we also make sure that there is no communication loss or no data loss, okay. So, whenever you are saying about total internal reflection, this diagram of total internal reflection, formula, and plus the two most important applications of total internal reflection, that is one will be optical fibers and second will be mirage, okay. These two points has to be included. Okay, so next topic here is refraction by the spherical surface, okay. In mirror equations or in mirror theory, we learn about only reflection. How about refraction? How is refraction caused? Whenever the ray of light moves from one medium to another medium, right. So, in this theory, whenever we talk about refraction, so what happens if I am considering a certain mirror, spherical mirror here. So, what will happen from one certain medium to another certain medium we are moving. Suppose in this case we are moving from a denser medium to a rarer medium, then what happens? Whatever the incident ray we are considering, that will be shifted depending on the property that in denser, from whenever we move from denser to rarer, then what happens? That your ray which is being refracted will be moving away from the normal, right. So, here in this case we can see, whenever we are moving from denser medium to rarer medium, this ray of light here is moving away from the normal whatever we are generated. So, this refraction theory is again is being used for the making a mirror. In here, whenever we design lenses, we need to consider this refraction theory in two forms, because in lenses we consider the spherical surface twice. Okay. So, here there is a certain relation which we are going to use in order to make sure that we can derive or generate or manufacture our lenses. So, here there is a simple formula which we use, wherein it will be defining you the refractive index relation with the help of or in relation to the object's placement, image placement and the radius of the curvature of the spherical mirror. So, whenever you are considering a lens, whenever you are considering a spherical mirror and there is a refraction of the ray from one medium to another medium, then the relation which we use is mu 1 upon v minus mu 2 upon u will be equal to mu 1 minus mu 2 upon r. This relation is used in order to just or with reference to only generating the lenses, or generating the mirror, what exactly must be the radius of curvature and hence what must be the focal length of the mirror, whatever we want to generate, and that will be with respect to in what medium exactly we need to use that thing. Okay, like if inside the water, like in submarines or something else, we need to use this mirrors, then what exactly is the depth and the refractive index depending on the salinity of the water. So hence in that case we require the refractive index of the certain mediums we are using. Okay, so in this relation, the placement of the object, the image formation's place and refractive index of both the mediums with respect to the radius of curvature, or you can say the focal length of the mirror, we can use this relation in order to make that lens formula. Okay, now talking about refraction for the spherical surfaces, if I am saying refraction by lens, then we have a certain lens maker's formula. In this formula is most important, which we use while manufacturing the lenses, which is given by 1 upon f is equals to mu 2 divided by mu 1 minus 1 bracket 1 upon r 1 minus 1 upon r 2. Now when I talk about lenses, it is always something like this which we consider. So here the radius of curvature of both the lenses which we are using has to be considered, including in what medium we are using this. So depending on the application, that in which in which medium we need to use, we can design the lenses accordingly, because we need to be very much precise with what must be the focal length of the lens we are generating. So here we can use this lens maker's formula, that is 1 upon f will be equal to mu 2 divided by mu 1 minus 1 bracket 1 upon r 1 minus 1 upon r 2, right. From the same relation we can derive thin lens formula, which is given by 1 upon f is equals to 1 upon v minus 1 upon u. Okay, so these are the two lens formulas which we use. One is lens maker's formula and second is thin lens formula. In thin lens formula, basically we just use the relation between the focal length, placement or the distance of the object and the distance of the image which has been generated by the lens. Similarly, in this case, as we had seen linear magnification in the mirror, similarly the linear magnification is used here also, which is given by h dash upon h, that is the height of the image generated to the height of the object, which will be given by v upon u. Okay, so the same thing goes here, that if your magnification is negative, then we say that the image which is generated will be real and inverted, whereas if your m is positive, we say that the image generated is inverted and erect, sorry, virtual and erect. Okay, talking about the power of the lenses, what do we understand by the power of lens? Power of lens is the tangent of the, tangent of what? Tangent of the angle at which your the ray is been incidented on the ray, which is given by 1 upon f. So here I can say the power is inverse of your focal length. Okay, and whenever we are going to Now, whenever we say that we are using lenses for certain properties or certain uses, like we magnify or we can increase your image size depending on whatever your application is. So, what will go through with the magnification and power and the focal length? So, if you are placing or there is a combination of the lenses, then for the combination of the lenses, what happens? Your focal length, the total focal length after the after certain combination. For example, if I am connecting or connecting three lenses, joining three different thin lenses, okay, so in that case what I will say, what will be the final focal length of this lens, okay? So in that case what we do here, if the focal length of first lens, second lens and third lens are f1, f2 and f3, then the final focal length of this combination will be calculated as 1 upon f will be equal to 1 upon f1 plus 1 upon f2 plus 1 upon f3, right? Similarly, power will be, similarly the power, the final power of this combination lens will be given by what? Simply we need to just add the powers. Why? Because as we know, power is simply the reciprocal of the focal length. So, using the same thing, we can say the final power, the final power of this focal lengths for final power of this lens combination, P will be equal to P1 plus P2 plus P3. And talking about the final magnification of this will become, if the magnification of this first lens is M1, second lens is M2 and third lens is M3, then magnification is simply multiplied. So, magnification of this will be given by M is equals to M1 into M2 into N3 and so on. So, as you go on increasing the number of lens combinations, your focal lens and power and magnification will change accordingly, okay? After this, we will see what happens when there is a refraction in the prism. Okay. So, in prism, when we talk about prism, what happens when the ray of light is been incident on one of the face of the prism, then there would obviously be the refraction concept coming, because your ray is moving from one medium to another medium. So, there will be a refraction taking place of this ray of light. So, if I am saying the I1 is the angle of incidence by which the ray is been emerging at the point or on the surface of the prism, then there will be the refraction occurring. So, here the first angle of refraction here is R1. Whereas on the second face of the prism or second side of the prism, the angle of refraction is said to be R2, and after that again this ray will be moving out from the prism, that there are two refraction taking place. First refraction is from first medium to second medium, and then again the second refraction is taking place from second medium to first medium. So, here the finally this ray is emerging out, and this angle will be said to be I2, or either you can call it to be E, okay? So, in this case you need to understand that what all angle calculations and how exactly this rays are being refracted, okay? So, here considering this quadrilateral, we can find that here there is a simple relation we need to remember about the angle of deviation delta. angle of deviation delta clearly is the angle difference which will be generated from this incident ray to this emerging ray. Okay, जिस एंगल से आपने प्रिज्म के अंदर ये रे को एंटर किया और जिस पॉइंट से वो निकल रहा है, तो इन दोनों के जो एंगल्स है उनका जो रिलेशन है या डिफरेंस है वो एंगल ऑफ डेविएशन, दिस इज व्हाट आई नीड टू कैलकुलेट. सो दिस डेल्टा इज द एंगल ऑफ डेविएशन विच हैज टू बी कैलकुलेटेड. ओके, सो व्हाट वुड बी द एंगल ऑफ डेविएशन हियर? Here we can clearly obtain from the derivation that angle of deviation will be something like this, which is obtained. Okay, here explaining in short, if you go up with the this quadrilateral, if this quadrilateral is to be considered P, M, Q and N, then this angle and this angle's addition will get to be 180 degree, and hence here you can calculate the this part and this part. After considering this delta, that is exterior angle triangle ki property, agar aap lagate ho, so you can finally obtain this relation that delta will be equal to I plus E minus A, where this angle A is the angle of prism and this is your deviation, which will be relating your angle of incidence and your angle of emergence. So aapko easily samajh mein aayega ki agar aapne ek certain angle of incidence pe ray ko इंसिडेंट किया है प्रिज्म के ऊपर, तो व्हाट एग्जैक्टली विल बी द इमर्जिंग एंगल यू कैन गेट. ओके, सो दिस इज वेरी मच इंपॉर्टेंट. डेल्टा एंगल ऑफ डेविएशन इज व्हाट इज बीन ऑलवेज आस्क्ड इन द थ्योरीज, सो यू नीड टू रिमेंबर एंड सम्स ऑल्सो. सो दिस रिफ्रैक्शन इन द प्रिज्म, दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू थ्योरी ऑल्सो एंड विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू योर सम्स ऑल्सो. ओके, so there is again one concept when I am saying this deviation. What if I need to make this deviation minimum? This minimum deviation is said to be dm, and this is what is mostly asked in numericals, that other than deviation you need to obtain what will be the minimum deviation angle you can obtain here in this case. So for minimum deviation you need to make sure that your r1 is equal to r2, or you can say in minimum deviation case, whatever this ray or light is passing inside the medium is always parallel to the base of medium. Okay, this is the most important condition in order to make sure that there is minimum deviation in the prism between the rays angles. Then this the ray which is passing inside the prism must be exactly parallel to the to its base, then we get the condition that r1 will be equal to I and I will become equal to E. So here your this deviation will be minimum, right? When your deviation will be minimum, when your angle of incidence and angle of emergence will be almost equal. In this case, if you are using this formula, we can get that angle of reflection r1 and r2 will be equal because these two are parallel, right? So in this case you can get dm to be equal to 2i minus a. After you solve this thing, you get this minimum deviation formula to be 2i minus a. Do remember this, deviation is different and minimum deviation is different. In minimum deviation what happens, the ray which is passing inside the prism will be exactly parallel to its base. Okay, and there condition comes that angle of incidence will be equal to angle of emergent and your angle r1 and r2 will be equal, and hence we can get dm to be equal to 2i minus a, where a is your angle of prism. Okay, so from this thing you can calculate I. What will be the value of I here? I will become equal to dm plus a and divide by 2. Okay, so this is your angle of incidence. Now again using the law of refraction, we know how do we calculate the refractive index. And here using the relation, here again there is the calculation of R. We can get R, which will be R1 equals to R2 will be equal to R, and 2R is A. So here we get angle of refraction to be A2. Okay. So finally we can obtain that after refraction, what is the refractive index of this thing. So we get mu2 upon mu1 will be equal to, as we know, this is sine of I upon sine of R. That will be given as sine of I. Now we know what is the value of I. Sine of I is dm upon a divided by 2 divided by sine of R, that is sine of R will be a divided by 2. Okay. Now here we know that whenever angles are very small, we can neglect the sine part. So here we can get that this sine or this refractive index mu21 could be easily related or written as dm upon a divided by 2 divided by a by 2, which can be related, which can be written as dm plus a divided by a. Okay. So this formula of minimum deviation has to be remembered properly. Okay. Whatever formula you need to remember or whatever formula you can easily remember, you can remember that. This thing won't make a large difference. Just remember the refractive index of one medium with respect to other for the prism will be sine of a plus dm divided by 2 divided by sine of a by 2. Okay. If you want to approximate these things, so this is the final relation which you get. Mu 21 will be equal to dm by a divided by a, where dm is the minimum deviation. And if there is no minimum deviation thing coming, so what is the deviation formula is I plus E minus A, where A is this angle, okay? This angle, which is said to be angle of prism, fine? And finally, finally you need to remember two other very important questions, that is telescope and microscope, okay? In that we had seen the derivations and everything. In that case also there would be the sums coming. So you need to remember those formulas properly. Okay, this is the prism's formula. Mu is equals to sine of a plus dm by 2 divided by sine of a by 2. Okay. Coming to microscope, there are two types of microscope. One is simple microscope and other is compound microscope. Okay. So as we know, what is exactly the use of microscope? Why do we use microscope? In order to just see the smaller things bigger. Okay. So our main aim is to, we need to magnify the image whatever we are getting. Okay. So in this case, whenever you're talking about microscope, you need to remember that magnification is the most important term which will come into picture. Okay. It's like in this thing, you can see what my object's height is very much less as compared to whatever image I'm generating. So here in theory, when you consider points, you need to remember that whenever you are about to see the object, the minimum distance at which your image must be generated is 25 centimeters. But we do not consider that part since it will create a certain kind of strain in our eye. So whenever your D is 25 centimeters, then in that case your image could be very precisely being seen by the human eye. But what is the issue? That when this condition is satisfied, there is a certain kind of strain which is generated in our eye, and hence we prefer mostly that your image must be at infinity. So in microscope we always consider, or we make the placement of the lenses in such a way that the image which is generated must be at infinity. Okay. So here in microscope we consider the magnification term to be 1 plus d by f. So this is, this formula has to be used when your certain distance of the image placements is to be considered. When there is a certain point, or in the sums it is being specified that image is generated at certain distance from the lens. Like here in, you can see this is the lens and the image generated is at a certain distance d. In this case, the magnification formula used is 1 plus d by f. But when I am saying that my image is generated at infinity, in that case your m becomes d by f. Do not forget this thing. This formula has to be used when your image is at infinity. Keep this thing in mind. And this has to be used when your image is at certain distance d. Okay? Similarly, like linear magnification, we in this case of microscope, we have an angular magnification. What do you understand by angular magnification here? That your angle of theta I by theta naught has to be calculated, which we can now obtain to be d by f. Okay? So here this angular magnification comes into picture. So in microscope, whenever you are asked to calculate magnification, you need to obtain this angular magnification, which is given by d by f. Now this is for simple microscope wherein only one lens is to be considered. When there is compound microscope, what we do, we use two lenses. One is your objective and second is your eyepiece. So objective is the lens which is placed near the object, whereas eyepiece is the lens which is placed near the eye. Okay, so in that case your magnification is twice, because there we are considering two lenses. That is one of objective and second is of eyepiece. So in that case your magnification becomes one, this will be given by L upon F naught, and this is given by D upon FE. Okay, so compound microscope, the magnification or angular magnification's formula is M is equals to L upon F naught and D upon FE. Considering this, that image, again in this case again you need to remember that this image is generated at infinity and not at a certain point or certain distance d. Okay, so the remaining part of this chapter, that is only left, we are only left with telescope, that will be continued in the